From the bottom of our hearts, we consider it such a privilege and such an honor to be able to add value to your life. We want you to grow spiritually, and for us to be able to speak hope, encouragement, direction, challenge, to be able to play a part in that gives us such incredible joy. My name is Pastor Jason Bentley, and on behalf of all of WaterVue Church, I just want to say today, welcome, and welcome to the family. We are all about relationships, we're all about people, we're all about community, and so you're in the right place. Even though you're engaging with us digitally, we want you to know that you are a part of our broader family, and this is an exciting day for WaterVue Church because today is Baptism Sunday. The first Sunday of every month is Baptism Sunday, where people are uniting with Christ in the waters of baptism, coming up out dead to their old ways, fully alive in Him. And in all of our in-person services today, we're baptizing. So help us to celebrate that. And if you want to get baptized, you can register below. A link is coming up, and we want you to be able to take the plunge, for you to take that next step that's going to change your life. And I want to say welcome back to those of you that have been engaging with us each and every week. And for those of you that are new, we consider you to be a VIP. You are a very important person, whether it's your first time, second time. Hey, we're just really glad that you're here. So stick around. Some good things are going to happen today. We are continuing our series that we started last week called Good Bones. And we want to make you aware of something. Because we're all about community and relationships, because we believe that we are better together, and you're loco if you fly solo, we're launching our spring semester of small groups. And small groups are smaller groups of people that meet outside of the big event known as our Sunday gathering to grow in their relationship with God and each other. The only way that we can grow in freedom and the only way that we can truly flourish, according to the Bible, is to be in right relationships. So we've got all kinds of different groups, groups for students, for women, men, so many different things happening this semester. Take a look at this to be thinking about what group that you can be a part of.
There are some things in life that you can't do alone, like play ping pong.
Yeah, baby.
Give yourself a root canal. Be stuck in a traffic jam.
Are you serious? Come on!
Perform a flash mob. Have a sack race.
Eight, set, go!
Got this! I'm gonna beat you! I got this! Yeah!
Go on a lunch date. Trust fall.
Okay, here I go. Falling.
Some things in life just don't work without the help of others. Your spiritual journey is one of them. When it comes to that, we're much better together. Today, we start our new small group semester that will last 13 weeks. That means that now is the time to go online, search the directory, and find a group that works for you. Call the leader and go for it. If you go, then you'll find out that real life change happens in the context of relationships. So don't hesitate and find your group today.
So it's pretty obvious that there are some things in life you cannot do alone, and live fully alive, flourish, and fulfilled is one of them. So a link is coming up below. It's our small group directory. Take a moment and click on that and search our different group options to find the one that works best for you. Doesn't matter really which one you choose. We just want you to get in a group because God has a friendship for you this semester that's gonna help you progress and help you to become everything that He intends for you to become. This is not a spectator sport. It takes involvement on all sides, and we are here for you. Again, to those of you that are joining us today for the first time, we consider you to be a VIP, and there's a digital card coming up below. And I would love for you to click that card. It just asks for some brief contact information because, as I mentioned, we're serious about being in relationship with you. Maybe you've just moved to Mooresville, the Lake Norman area, and a job brought you here, or just a change of life. Maybe you don't have many friends or family. Maybe you're watching us somewhere across the country, but you're feeling isolated and lonely right now. It doesn't have to be that way. Click on that digital card, share your information. We're not gonna do anything weird. We have a hassle-free guarantee. We're just gonna connect with you and make sure that we're bringing you alongside of us into everything that God has prepared for us. So take a moment, click that link, because you're trusting us enough with that information. Here's what we're gonna do. We are going to, on your behalf, in your honor, feed a child in extreme poverty in the nation of Honduras or Ethiopia. 3 meals in a day through our global partner, One Child. We're that committed to together us changing the world. It's time for worship, and worship is so very important because it exalts Jesus, but it also prepares our heart and mind for what He's getting ready to speak into us. I want to mention that you have the opportunity to worship the Lord through your giving. We thank you for being generous and for putting God first with the tithes and with the offerings, and because of you resourcing what God is doing through WaterVue Church, we're able to do in-person gatherings and provide this online content. And we're seeing God do fantastic things. And in the days ahead, we're gonna share more stories about how God is moving and how God is touching hearts and changing lives. But remember this, when you give, you get blessed, people get saved, and God gets the glory. So some ways that you can give are coming up on the screen. We are not trying to take anything from you. We just want to open up an opportunity for you to live a life of generosity. The Bible says that the world of the generous, it gets larger and larger. So thank you for your heart to support us. And remember, whatever you do, it is an act of worship. Let's worship Him together.
Sunset's green, oh, he's green.
Your attention back to our two anchor passages. The first is in Ezekiel and the other is in Proverbs. But Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse number 25 says this, "For here's what I'm going to do." And remember, this is the Lord speaking. And he says, "Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pour pure water over you and scrub you clean." So there's this idea of getting clean and getting healthy. And then I'm going to give you a new heart and I'm going to put a new spirit in you. Now's a good time to fist bump your neighbor and tell them he's talking about good bones. "I'll give you a new heart. I'll put a new spirit in you. I'll remove the stone heart from your body and I'll replace it with a heart that's God-willed, not self-willed. I'll put my spirit in you and make it possible for you to do what I tell you and to live by my commands." In other words, if we're going to live out what Jesus has for our life, we got to be healthy. We got to be whole on the inside. Now, Proverbs 4, Solomon, wise Solomon, this is what he says, Proverbs 4, 23, "Guard your heart above all else." Yeah, it's time for heart care. It's time for soul care. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. That's how important your heart is. It determines how everything else is going to go. Healthy me equals healthy we. And so as we start today talking about good bones again, I'll say this, some things are just not meant to be featured as boneless. Donuts, for one, are not supposed to be advertised as boneless. And number two, watermelon is something else that's not supposed to be featured as boneless. Who in the world gave these people this idea? I don't know. My mind's blown right now. But another thing that's not meant to be boneless, and you may disagree with me, but I'll fight you on this, and that is chicken wings. Hey, chicken wings, whether we're talking about lemon pepper, buffalo style, barbecue, whatever you prefer, chicken wings are meant to be served with the bone in. Come on, somebody, the way God intended. Boneless wings are whack. You can keep those boneless wings. And another thing that is also not meant to be boneless is your life. You were created to have good bones. And you know, in reality, the majority of people that are around us, most of our friends and our coworkers, maybe people in our family, the sad truth of the matter is way too many of them are not focusing on good bones. They're actually focusing on aesthetics. People love features. We love the way this looks, and we love what that does, and we love what stands out here, and we love how obviously awesome this is. You know, we love aesthetics and we love features. But the first thing that I want to leave with you here today is that features cannot be the foundation that you build forever on. You can't build something that's strong, something that's going to last just on features. And the purpose of this series is to highlight and to teach you that truly godly people, truly successful people recognize this truth, which is the big idea for this whole series, that we can only build the life we truly want and the life we need when we have good bones. And I know that you're familiar with the terminology good bones. It's become a real estate terminology. It's become a home improvement one. The idea of good bones is that a house has core strength. Maybe it doesn't look the best on the outside, but it has core strength. It's got foundational stability. It's got central overall health and potential. But this is true not just of houses. Our marriages and our friendships are meant to have good bones. We gotta stop worrying about what everyone else can see and really start focusing on getting it right on the inside. Our marriages and friendships, our families, our church, our community, we've got to spend the necessary time developing, establishing, and caring for good bones, because it is the core of something. It is the bones that determines the true wellness of everything else. And if we will focus on what's going on inside of us, if we'll focus on soul care, if we'll focus on inner strength, if we'll focus on heart wellness, it's gonna affect your future growth potential and your ability to truly flourish in all of the other arenas of your life. Good bones, establishing good bones equates to better marriages, stronger churches, healthier communities, less toxic workplaces. If we would focus on getting good bones, it's going to change the landscape of our life as we know it. But the truth of the matter, if you were honest with yourself, you would have to, as you take a good look deep down inside after everything that we've been through together for the last couple of years, we're not well. And I feel like this series is so timely. And I'm thankful that the Holy Spirit is taking us on this adventure together. We're not well. We're soul sick. Way too many people that I talk to are dealing with anxiety, and they're dealing with depression, and they're addicted to something, or they're filled with shame. People are angrier than they've ever been. Road rage, cancel culture. People are unsatisfied. They're discontent, easily offended. Man, we are so unfulfilled. Jesus came so that we could live an abundant, fulfilled life, but the majority of us are completely unfulfilled. We're constantly comparing. We're deeply insecure. Man, I'm talking to people that are just perpetually wandering from job to job, from church to church, from relationship to relationship. And so when we're dealing with these realities, here's what happens. Number one, we start feeling badly. And then secondly, we start behaving badly. Now, I'm not here to shame you about feeling bad or being bad, but I want you to see that badness is the result of brokenness. Whether we're talking about feeling badly or behaving badly, badness is the result of brokenness. So in order to change our badness, we have to fix our brokenness. But the way that we typically try to fix feeling badly and behaving badly, the way that we typically try to address it or to fix it, it's not working and it's not going to work, because here's what we typically do when we feel bad and we start behaving bad. Number one, we devote ourselves to image management. We're so image conscious and we want everyone to perceive us in the right way. We work really hard on our presenting selves. And so we paint fake smiles on our faces, and we've learned the art of making everything in our life appear as though it's in order. And social media, Facebook and Instagram, wow, it really helps us with that, because we can put a filter on something. It's basically a perpetual highlight reel of our life. And so we manage our image, and we do this by hiding and covering up the things that are going on inside of us. We're not going around letting people know that we're filled with anxiety. We're not letting people know how depressed we are. We're not letting people know that we have become addicted to this thing or that we're just filled with shame. No, we hide it and we cover it up and we become masters at pretend. You know, when I was a child and even now as a father, as I watch my boys, a big part of that whole experience is make-believe, it's pretend. But as we grow into adulthood and we start pursuing careers and families and all of those things, I've learned that we don't really ever outgrow that whole make-believe and pretend thing. We are all trying to pretend in some way. What do you right now pretend isn't your problem? What are you pretending doesn't exist or pretending like is not really affecting you? I've learned that my hurdle to holiness and wholeness is when my desire to look good is greater than my desire to be good. What's more important to you? Just having the veneer, the aesthetic of having it together, or actually getting whole, actually getting healed on the inside? So the way that we typically try to fix badness is image management. Another way is self-medication. We have become, as a society, addicted to the release of dopamine. We love the feel-good chemicals that are either naturally created or that we can fabricate with some other kind of chemical. So we address a spiritual issue with a chemical cure. So as we're trying to self-medicate and make ourselves feel better, we spend our way into incredible debt. And you know, when you're buying something new and you're finding this sale, there's that release of dopamine. It feels good to get something that you want, to put on a new fit and to have someone say, "Wow, where'd you get that ride? It looks so great." And so we are spending, trying to self-medicate. We're using substances to try to self-medicate. And whether that's alcohol or pills or some other thing, we're using substances because we want to cover up, we want to mask all of that hurt and all of that stuff, that junk that's going on deep down inside of our hearts, all the way down to the bones. We're thrill seekers, we're adrenaline chasers, so we're jumping out of airplanes and getting in shark cages and doing all kinds of crazy things because we want that release of adrenaline, because with that, it counteracts that low feeling, that bad feeling. So we're constantly trying to travel, constantly trying to go on vacation, chasing the next thrill, the next fun time. And we're doing it because we feel bad and we feel like a change of scenery, and all of that is gonna help fix what's going on deep down inside. And then there's some of us that utilize sex as a way to help bring us out of our funk and to address the wounds in our soul. And you may be thinking right now, well, why, this is a church, why are you talking so much about substances and sex and spending? But that's exactly right. I'm talking to the church, and these things are not just happening with people that are not believers. These things are playing out in our lives because we're not well. We're soul sick. We need soul care. We got to focus on getting good bones. And then the third thing that we do is behavior modification. We're either going to go the route of image management, the route of self-medication, or the route of behavior modification. And with that, we just determine, you know what, I'm going to act better, I'm going to do better, I'm going to get more discipline, I'm going to get some stronger boundaries, I need to read a good self-help book, I need to get into yoga or therapy. And we try to modify our behavior. And I recognize that the church has been very guilty of this and still is. Oftentimes, all the church offers to people is a strong message of change your behavior. When someone has a hurt or a habit or a hangup, we just throw moralisms at them like, hey, just stop that. Hey, don't you see that's wrong? Get a grip. Get some accountability. We say, do this more, do that less. But hear me, just addressing, whether it's self-medication, image management, or behavior modification, just addressing the symptoms isn't going to cure the disease. We are not experiencing the flourishing, abundant life in Jesus because we're focused on everything but getting good bones and developing soul care. Jesus taught us that the root issue is always our heart. In Matthew chapter number 15 and verse number 18, Jesus says, but what comes out of your mouth reveals the core of your heart, and you will find living with an impure heart, with a sick heart, with a not well heart, it produces evil ideas, murderous thoughts, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, lies, slander. That's what pollutes a person. Jesus says it's what's in the heart that corrupts. It's what's in the heart that affects what we say and what we do. Good and bad, it flows from our heart. And if we're going to experience true transformation, we must deal with the issues of the heart and not simply external behaviors. And that's why Solomon said, guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. It's your heart that's going to determine your outlook. It's your heart that's going to determine your mood. It's your heart that's going to determine how you feel. It's your heart that's going to determine your relationships. It's your heart that's going to determine how satisfied you are with career and all of these things. It's the spring, and right now it's the time to start getting prepared to get a good looking yard. If you're like me, you're going to want to have a nice yard. I'm in a really beautiful subdivision, and my neighbor just a few houses down has the absolute most incredible yard. In fact, I have yard envy. Like, I'll go out and I'll spend hours just standing on the sidewalk looking at his yard thinking, man, I wish my yard was that beautiful. I wish it looked that good. And it never really dawns on me that if I would just spend time working on my yard, fertilizing my yard and taking care of it, it could look like the neighbors. But it's just so much easier, you know, to just stand and to just be jealous of what my neighbor has. And right now, my yard is filled with weeds. They're starting to pop up already, and I realized I got to do something about them. So when I first moved into my house, when I'd see a weed pop up, I'd just go and kind of rip it out, and it would just come back, and I would just be all the time addressing dandelions and other weeds. And I should have known. I'm not a gardener. I'm not a green thumb. I should have known this, but weeds, they're going to return unless I address them at the root, unless I pull them out by the root, or I put something in there that's going to kill them at the root. And it's the same with what's happening in our hearts. We have to get to root issues. We have to work on establishing good bones. God knows that if we get our hearts healthy and if we get our hearts rightly aligned with Him, our image and our behaviors are going to follow. We're not going to have to worry about those things if we get our hearts right. But if we only get our behaviors in line, let's say that you succeed with behavior modification, and just through sheer willpower, you're able to stop drinking, or you're able to address some other struggle in your life. If we only get our behaviors in line, but without dealing with the condition of our hearts, we are going to be left with a soul that has dark places in it, and we're going to be left with a life full of judgment and not love. The key to deal with what's going on in our heart, the key to deal with some of the behaviors and the emotions and the symptoms that are manifesting in our lives is to take a deeper look. And so when you start feeling anxious or shameful, or when you start feeling full of anger and rage, or when you feel insecure, pause and ask yourself the question, what is going on underneath this? What's driving this? Why am I doing what I'm doing? When you focus on good bones, you deal with the disease, not just the symptoms. You deal with the roots and not just the leaves. You deal with the soul, not just the behavior. Jesus wants your heart. And that's what you've got to understand. That's really all that he wants. He wants your heart, and he wants you to be healed. He wants you to be healthy. He wants you to be whole. He wants you to be fruitful and faithful. He wants you to be free. He wants you to be fulfilled. Jesus knows that if he has your heart, that he'll get every other part of you. The totality of your heart equals the totality of your life. Your heart leads the way. Your heart determines the course of your life. And you cannot fix the problems in your soul. You can't fix the problems that you are wrestling with. Maybe no one else knows about it, but the things that when you lay your head to rest at night, the things that are haunting you and troubling you, you cannot fix those things in your soul with just a change in aesthetics or just a change in behavior. You can't even fix it self-medicating. That may work just for a brief span of time, but it's gonna create even more problems, because it's like putting a fresh coat of paint on a house that has been ravaged by termites. One thing that I hope you'll never forget is that you will never gain in effort what you can only gain in surrender. Some of you have been working so hard and spending so much money trying to do so much to rid yourself of what's going on, and you've put in so much work and so much effort, but you'll never gain in effort what you can only gain in surrender. Jesus did the hard work for you. He lived the sinless life. He died on the cross. He paid for the penalty of your sins. He was without sin. He was without all of these issues, but he paid the price for you so that you could be whole, so that you could be free. So why are you trying to work so hard? You're meant to surrender. Surrender to Jesus. Let him have your heart. Let him come and have access to everything that you are, the deep down inside part of you that you're trying to maintain control of. If you'll just surrender that to him, it can all be different. So let's start working on good bones. Last week, we explored the need for self-awareness and being self-aware enough to pursue freedom and to take responsibility. Today, we're going to pursue good bones, and we're going to pursue some soul health by being intentional with the atmosphere of our lives. That's really what we're going to wrap up with here today, is talking about how you can create a new atmosphere for your life, because there is a specific atmosphere that allows hope and healing to occur, that best allows it to thrive over time. And that is an atmosphere of faith. We have got to be intentional in establishing an atmosphere of faith, because it is faith that triumphs over fear. It is faith that gives us the strength to keep pressing forward when everything in us says to stop, to quit, or to give up. We've got to have faith. That's why the writer in the New Testament said, the just will live by faith, that without faith, it's impossible to please God. And the greater that we can nurture our faith, the greater that we can grow and establish our faith, the more powerful we'll be and the easier it will be for us to have the necessary good bones. And it's in that ideal atmosphere of faith where there are three essential components that are going to create the faith where healing and where freedom flourish. The first component is God's truth. God's truth. You know, right now in our culture, you hear a lot about you need to share your truth, or that's hashtag my truth. But at the end of the day, my friends, it's not about my truth. And it's not about your truth. Because if your and my truth made a difference, so many things would be different. It's about God's truth. His truth is what has always been, and His truth will remain. His word, we're talking about the Bible, we're talking about His truth, His word. It is the ultimate authority on all things, on matters of ethics and morality, spirituality, and more. And we read His word. We're going to build this atmosphere of faith in our life by reading His word, not out of obligation or not out of some sense of duty, but as a GPS guiding us into fullness and discovery, as a lens to help us to see Jesus and to see His greatness and His heart and who He truly is and how much He really loves us, as a light that is freeing us from shadows and secrets and darkness. And His word, His truth, it's an anchor that's going to keep us solid and stable in a constantly shifting world. We're not going to change His word to fit us. We're not going to change His word to fit our politics or our opinions. We're going to align ourselves with His intention and with His desire. We're going to submit to God's truth. Hear me, every time we pick up the Bible, every time that you read the YouVersion Bible app, or you actually pick up a paper Bible and begin to address it, every time we do that, we are one revealed truth away from a fresh encounter with the living God. His word is alive, and it's powerful, and it's relevant. In fact, the Bible, even though it was written thousands of years ago in a completely different culture where they spoke multiple different languages, it is as fresh and relevant and contemporary as tomorrow's headline and as tomorrow's newsfeed. His word is here to change us and to create an atmosphere of faith, because as we're reading it, His Spirit, the presence of God, is going to breathe on one word or on a phrase in it, causing that to stir something on the inside of you. And maybe some of you can relate to what I'm talking about. Maybe you've read this one thing many times before. You heard your mom talk about it, or you remember a Sunday school teacher referring to it. You've heard it many times, but when you read it, it's like it leaps off of the page, and it's like God is coming near saying, this is for you. This is a fresh way to consider this. And really what that is a moment of divine breakthrough. It's an opportunity for God to pierce your heart with His light of truth. And that's how deep transformation can begin. King David wrote in Psalms 19, he said, without this revelation light, how would I ever detect the waywardness of my heart? Lord, forgive my hidden flaws whenever you find them. Keep cleansing me, God, and keep me from my secret selfish sins. David was acquainted with the need for establishing good bones and getting some soul care going on. May they never rule over me, for only then will I be free from fault and remain innocent of rebellion. So may the words of my mouth, my meditation, thoughts, and every movement of my heart be always pure and pleasing, acceptable before your eyes, my only Redeemer, my Protector God. The second component of building an environment of faith so that we can be nurtured into a place of healing and wholeness is life-giving community. We've got to have God's truth, and we've got to have life-giving community. And the reason for this is because it is hard to live the right life around the wrong people. It's been said that you are and that you are going to be the average of the five people that you hang around the most. So maybe it's a good idea right now to look around and check out your circle. Check out who's riding with you. I know that they've maybe been in your corner for years, but maybe you need to ask yourself, are the people that I hang around helping me draw closer to God? Maybe things would be different in your life if you would take a good look at who you call friend and ask yourself, are they helping me heal? And are they helping me get whole? Or are they keeping me in shadows and secrets? Freedom occurs. Healing occurs. Soul care, good bones, all of that grows and develops in an environment where people live open, honest, confessional lives that are filled with grace. And that's why here at WaterVue Church, we have a culture of authenticity. We encourage people to be real, to not hide their struggles, to openly share them in right relationships. And that's also why small groups are one of the big four operational things that we do. We recognize that it takes life-giving community to get us to a place of wholeness. It will help us grow in freedom. The Apostle James writes in chapter 5, "Make this your common practice. Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you can live together whole and healed. The prayer of a person living right with God is something powerful to be reckoned with." We underestimate so many times how much God loves people. But even more than that, we underestimate the friendships God is wanting to use to show this. We're meant to get around right people, Jesus loving, Jesus serving, Jesus following, faith-filled people. Isolation is going to hinder our progress. We're not supposed to try to live out faith on our own. This is not meant to be done by ourselves. In fact, as I've said, isolation is going to hinder our progress. We're not going to be able to move as far or as fast alone like we could if we were in a small group with other people helping us along the way. God surrounds us with people so that we can hear about their past, so that we can hear about what they've overcome, so we can hear about how they've healed, so that it doesn't become our future, so that their past isn't recreated, so that we can also heal, so that we can become whole. The final component is we're building this faith-filled atmosphere so that we can have good bones and have soul wellness is the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. It takes God's truth, it takes life-giving community, and it takes the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Notice that when Ezekiel talks about us having a new and a healthy heart, it required an infusion of the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Ezekiel records the Lord saying, "I'm going to take that old heart out of you and I'm going to put a new heart in you. And then I'm going to put my spirit in you, and it's going to be like pure water, and it's going to cleanse you, and it's going to fill you up." We need it. We need the Spirit of God. We need His presence and power to establish good bones and to maintain wellness within. We need the presence of God to heal our hearts and past traumas, disappointments, and hurts. We need the power of God to deliver us from Satan's grip. Is His presence and His power in your life a reality? Is the Holy Spirit just something that you're talking about? Is it something that you're rarely thinking about? Is it something that you're actually encountering? Is it alive? Is it vibrant? Is it present? It was when the church began. It was in the early church. It was in early Christians. The Apostle Paul writes about it like this in 1 Corinthians 2. He says, "My message and my preaching, the way that I live my life, they were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power. For God intended, notice, for God intended that your faith not be established on man's wisdom, but in His almighty power. He's always intended for us to have His presence working. And the problem with so many churches and the problem with so much of our Christianity is that it is devoid of His presence and power. And a life of faith and a church that is lacking the presence of God, that's lacking the Holy Spirit, it's like an empty tomb. There's a slight smell that would indicate that Jesus was one time there, but He's never seen or He's never experienced. And that is not God's intention. We're not supposed to just have a bunch of nice ideas and empty rhetoric. It's supposed to be powerful. What this is living in us is meant to be a surge, a connection of power. And when the presence and power of God, when they're a part of our belief system, but absent from our practice, there is a significant gap in the integration and relevance of true faith in our lives. I can trace all of the most significant and spiritually impacting moments of my life back to the presence and power of God being manifest. I can look back to specific times, specific moments where God spoke to me, where God revealed Himself to me, where God filled me, where I encountered God, where I just sensed that something supernatural was going on. And it was these God moments that produced transformation. It was these God moments that left a deep impression on my faith. And I will always live now with a fresh understanding, because a man with an experience is never at the mercy of a man with just an argument. The Lord is meant to be encountered. He's meant to be experienced. And we're lacking good bones, and we're going to lack good bones if His presence is missing. So His truth, life-giving community, His presence and power, that's going to create an atmosphere of faith in your life so that you can begin to heal, so that you can begin to become whole, so that you can live in freedom. And I want to give you that chance here today. There's no sense in you staying in a place of defeat. And there's no sense in you just continuing to suffer in silence. Your faith, maybe it's at a low point, maybe it's dead, it can come alive today. You're just going to need to make a fresh start and surrender. This is your opportunity to throw open the floodgates to Him and allow Him in. Jesus is a gentleman. He's not going to force His way in. That's why He said, I stand at the door and knock. And He's been knocking. And I know that you felt it. I know that you have sensed Him desiring to do something in you, something for you that's uncommon. Maybe you've been pushing it aside, but today's the day. Take advantage of this moment right now. And I want to pray with you. I'm going to pray that you make the decision to surrender, that you make a decision to make a fresh start. His presence and power can flood you right now. If you'll ask for it, it's going to come. Jesus said that's all we have to do. We've just got to ask. And right now, this can be a moment that one day in the future, you'll be able to trace all the goodness and all the development and all the progress. You'll be able to trace it back to this moment. Wherever you are, maybe you're on your job, driving in your car, sitting in your living room, maybe you're sitting in bed, you might be in a million different places, maybe you're on the beach right now, I don't know where you are, but your moment of destiny, your moment of transformation can be traced back to right now. So let's pray. Will you close your eyes with me? Will you pray this prayer? Lord Jesus, I believe You are the one true God. And I surrender to You in this moment. I want everything You have for me. I'm asking You to forgive me of my sins. And don't just forgive me of wrong behaviors. I want You to go into my heart and I want You to see what's causing it. I want you to heal my brokenness. I'm feeling bad, and maybe I'm behaving bad because I'm broken inside, and only You are the one that knows how to fix it. You said that you would heal the brokenhearted. You would bind up their wounds. So I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I give you my life. Maybe from the outside, it looks like I've got it all together. Or maybe people are thinking that it's falling apart, but it doesn't matter, Lord. I stand right now in your moment before you and you alone. Heal me, strengthen me, free me. Give me everything that you have. Give me the best of heaven. I'm ready. In Jesus' name, amen. You making a fresh start today is undoubtedly the easiest and yet the hardest thing that you've ever done before. But remember what we just mentioned, that you'll never gain in effort what you'll only gain in surrender. Today, you surrendered your heart, your life to Jesus, and His Holy Spirit is flooding. It's rushing in right now to begin to heal your soul, to begin to bind up the wounds in your heart. You are on your way to good bones, and we celebrate with you. We count this such an extraordinary privilege to be with you in this life-changing moment, to say yes to Jesus, to say yes to the life of faith. And maybe this fresh start was for the very first time or for the first time in a long time, but we are with you and we celebrate with you. And we are gonna stand beside you every step of the way to make sure that you receive all that God has for your life. So there's a link coming up below that says Fresh Start. I want you to take a moment and click that link and share some brief contact information, because we want to send you a free resource. It's a book called Following Jesus, and it's going to help you as you walk out your new faith in Christ, so that you can be strong, so that you can be bold and courageous, so that you can be filled with faith. And we've got that for you if you'll just take one moment and to fill out that card. Also, we want you to know that we're praying for you. In fact, a link is coming up below. If you have anything that you need prayer about, whether you need healing or you need a new job, a financial breakthrough, you're just feeling overwhelmed, please don't suffer in silence. Let us know. There's a link below. Click that link to share your prayer request. We want to come alongside you in prayer. And this wraps up our time together this week.